So I really want to be in the playoffs. I want to go to Worlds. That's my biggest dream right now. So I'm just pretty hyped. Even though the Super Week didn't went too good for us, we are still pretty hyped and we didn't think too much about the Super Week. We just will focus on the playoffs and go to Worlds.
Well, one thing's for sure, Kevin's got a hell of a hot, tough road ahead of him if he wants to make that dream come true. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We are about to head into game three between SK Gaming and Millenium. And right now, SK Gaming lead 2-0. It could well be a clean sweep. Millenium, they need to throw everything they can at this match. They've spent a little time off the stage. They've clearly needed to discuss and find out what the hell they are going to adjust for this game.
If I were SK Gaming, I don't think they need to adjust anything. You know, you go back to the previous games, Jezzers has been allowed Ahri. He's gone 11-1-14. And I just think for SK, they've got a very comfortable spot. I know it's Millenium that need to change stuff, but I just think it's at the moment, a massive mountain to climb because it's SK that have outclassed, they were out-mechanical, they were out-strategizing their opponents. Game one was slow, game two was dominant.
Yeah. 25 minutes they were in space. I mean, they just outmaneuvered them so many times and just caught them out of position. And you got to wonder, I mean, we were talking about picks and bans. We thought Orianna probably should have been let through and gone with the Nidalee and Maokai back.
Yep.
Instead, they choose to let Nidalee through, got picked. They choose to let Maokai through in game one, got picked. Both times been against Kevin's Aatrox, who we just heard his dream is to get to that World Championships. And I personally would question whether Aatrox is the right pick for that.
It's not working. He's lost his lane twice. Lost to Maokai, lost to Nidalee. As you pointed out, Kerb, Ziggs didn't work so well. His Fizz was better, but not by a big margin. And it just feels like Millenium are not really firing on all cylinders, I think is the best way to describe
it. Any cylinders, honestly, in my opinion.
You know, and you know, the Alistar as well for Jayree. It's just not having an impact. This is also one of the scenarios, Deficio said it quite rightly, in the meta at the moment, it's about those late game hyper carries. It really is Tristana, Kog'Maw, who's really at the top of the pile. And Creighton's pulled out Lucian and Corki. Now, I don't mind Corki. I think if you punish a mid-game power spike, you can do well with a Corki. His range, his poke, his mixed damage is very difficult to deal with. When you get ahead, you can win early. But you need to do all those things. And it kind of feels like sometimes you look at a patch and you sometimes misinterpret what is powerful and what can work. Maybe Millenium have done that. Maybe Millenium have come into this game with some assumptions because, again, they're playing 4.13 for the first time, really. Maybe they've just done the wrong homework for the series.
What I've noticed, certainly in the last game, was obviously Millenium were the ones that were going to try and be aggressive. They were trying to make the kills. We saw, of course, the Evelynn coming around, Blue Pot trying to get in there, Jayree getting in, Flash, Pulverize. But Enraitor was there every time.
Yep.
Dark Binding after Dark Binding has worked so well for him. Maybe that's even something they need to look towards. Jayree on Alistar. It is not working.
No, it really isn't. And we are seeing the same bans thus far. SK have banned all three of the same champions they have in the two previous games.
Ooh.
Irelia, TF, and Zillion, and this is now a change for Millennium.
Yeah, they've let Maokai through and Nidalee through. So they've given Kevin the choice, and they're going to attempt to take the other one. I think he's actually going to go Maokai.
I wonder if this... Yeah, I think Maokai would be the preference. And I wonder if Millennium were hoping that it's going to be Nidalee and they could pick Maokai.
I think they're going to first pick Morgana again. And then they're just going to say, fine, we're going to see what you go with. And well, no, they're not. They don't want to risk Maokai going
through. Actually like your idea, because the chances of locking in both Nidalee and Maokai are slim to none. But in the same token, if SK are adamant that in terms of the priority picks, this is the way to go, I would love to see this. It worked well in Challenger. Chachi did a great job with Swain. How practiced is Kevin with Swain, if he's going to lock it in?
No, changed it. Goes to the Kog'Maw Morgana, but it's a big change. It's the support change, and they've also stolen away SK's
Duo lane
completely.
Yes, Morgana Kog'Maw has been right in both of the previous games for SK, so Millennium have already leveled up their pick and ban phase. They've got a relevant AD carry. They've stolen away Enraitor's Morgana, who was landing so many dark bindings, but like we said, it is late game ADCs. Tristana is the theoretical opposite number to Kog'Maw.
Yeah, and there's so many options available to it. Nami alongside Tristana, it is a strong, potent lane. If you get caught out, you could well be in trouble. So immediately, SK, they're like, fine, you're going to take away our first choice. We can switch straight to this, and it is a strong second choice.
Do you see how decisive SK are in the picks and bans? They took a little while for them, Maokai, but in the previous games as well, SK have been very, very on point, and they've been very quick to react in what they wanted to lock in. And I think we're going to look at Emperor Palpatine once again.
This is top lane Cal this time around. Lee Sin also picked up by Kotnix, despite the changes. Of course, he will fall away on the late game. Doesn't have that attack speed nerf as heavy as he would do when he used to get on towards that AD carry instead. We'll see if it works out. We'll see whether they're going to get to that late game stage and whether Kotnix can really put pressure on it, because as so far, hasn't had a great impact.
Agreed. His Jarvan was non-existent, really. His Evelynn just got shut down by Enrated's Morgana and Dark Bindings on so many occasions. So back to a comfort pick, back to something that he's played a boatload. This will be his 14th game in summer. He played 13 in the summer split. He's got 8 wins with that champion, so that's a pretty good win-loss ratio. But it's the top Cal that's going to be interesting to me. Where and how is Kevin going to play this? Because we've seen Trinity force into Static Shiv yesterday, and then we've seen a tank build later in the matchup. So what itemization route is Kevin going to take against this Maokai?
Of course, the Ziggs was picked in there. We saw Svensk going on. Karzix already looks is locked in for the mid lane for Kerb. Is this what they needed? It's a shake-up for sure from Millenium, but is it something untested?
I like Lux in this matchup. I think the range advantage that you're going to have, the wave clear you're going to have against Ziggs, and also the ability to lock down both a Karzix or a Maokai that dash into you with that light binding. I mean, it's going to root two people in place. It is very, very powerful. When you combine that with a Dark Binding, when you combine that with a Pulverize, there is a lot of hard CC that can come into play. But I do think it is very relevant for Kerb and Kevin to have a strong start to the game, because if they aren't able to get those bindings, get that CC, and keep Kreaton alive with that Kog'Maw to Kaiten, you know, lay down the smackdown, I just think they're going to get trampled over. Lux, of course, her passive does more damage in 4.13. So small changes, small tweaks. She's more relevant in the late game because it now has an ability power ratio.
If she wants to risk walking up and landing that pot, that's for sure. It's a risky, risky
try. Or if someone jumps on you, you can get the damage
but
down.
But honestly, for Millenium, this is the time to take risks. Yep. This is where they have to try something. Who do you guys at home think has the edge heading into this game? Is it the final game? That's the question. Tweet out hashtag SKWin or hashtag MILWin to at LOL Esports, and we'll check out your votes. Also, don't forget, ladies and gentlemen, to use the LCS big plays if you see something you think is outstanding. There's been a few so far.
Yep.
Great plays, especially from SK's side.
Mine's a slightly non-standard one. I really like the way SK peeled away from a bottom lane fight, dodging all the spells and ended up getting kills. I mean, it's just such great understanding of the situation.
So here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Game 3. Will it be the final one? Will it be a clean sweep for SK Gaming? Or will Millenium manage to strike back? They are 2-0 down. Rokkan, of course, managed to put Super Hot Crew in a similar situation yesterday. Super Hot Crew did manage to drag that game back, but it was a long, hard-fought battle, which they ended up losing 3-1. Of course, they will be facing Fnatic. The winner of this will face Alliance. And it seems Millenium are on one of their famed invades.
They've got such a strong level one. I mean, flash for flash on supports. That's a okay trade, and we'll see if any jungler can punish it. But with Dark Binding, with Light Binding, with Pulverize, the level one is definitely sitting in favor of Millenium. I want to go back to something that you said just at the end of Picks and Bans, was you're 2-0 down on a best of five, and you know, why not pull out all the stops or you know, take a risk? I actually think Millenium took risks in game one and two. Lucian was a risk, Corki was a risk, Alistar support was a risk both times. And it didn't work out for Millenium. So this time around, it's their third gambit, as it were. And we'll see if this one can actually work out in their favor.
Well, if you've not seen top lane Cow at all yesterday, if you weren't a keen-eyed viewer, we'll be starting. We'll see if he goes the same route that we've seen so far, which is the Trinity Force into Static Shiv into possibly a Frozen Heart. Of course, that will be changing because he's up against a double AP comping Freddy and Jezzes on Maokai and Ziggs.
It's actually quite difficult to itemize because there is a fair amount of damage from obviously Ziggs and Maokai. Then you've got a lot of physical damage from both Kha'Zix and Candy Panda, especially if Svenskeren goes for that sort of early armor penetration build. But luckily, Kevin's got a press R to survive most things button. And we'll see how effectively he uses it. I actually likened the Trinity Force Static Shiv build and playstyle to a split push Shyvana playstyle, because you've got that trample passive on Alistar, which does give you a slightly more effective wave clear. It's not a massive amount of damage, but it will allow you to push a wave fairly quickly. And when you get those static shiv procs and the attack speed, etc., in conjunction with your pulverize, you can actually clear waves very, very quickly. So we'll see if Kevin does play that split push role and does play that route, because top lane Cow is very exciting.
Interesting start between these two mid lanes. Jez has thrown out those bouncing bombs, and not a lot of them are connecting with Kerb so far, who's happily just to focus on the farm, sidestep those bombs. But again, as a Ziggs, very easy to farm out. Will just keep his CS very tight between them. See how that one progresses. Quick Candy Panda putting the explosive shot onto Kraton. Get that little burn dot ticking away on him. Kraton, of course, led in the last match in CS. Finally managed to get himself a little bit of an edge on it, but Candy Panda has been fantastic throughout. Incredible stats across these games. 10-1-7 in game one, 7-2-9, I believe, in the last matchup as well. Explosive shot working well, wiping out the wave, keeping the pressure.
Oh, Bubble's not going to connect in Wraith. Might be in a little bit of trouble.
They're going to go for it. Connex comes around the side, lands the Sonic Wave, but in Wraith, the heal comes down, jumps on him from Candy Panda, gets the slow on Connex. Nicely done. And SK are free.
So good attempt by Millenium. They get the flash, not the flash, rather the heal from Candy Panda. But a very, very smart rocket jump from Candy Panda, actually slowing Cotnex down, preventing him going further. I was going to say before the gank came in, if you actually looked at Candy Panda and Rated, they were poking Kreaton and JRE very effectively. In between Candy's CSing and Enrated's positioning, they were putting a lot of auto attacks and spell casts onto their opponents, which Kreaton and JRE had no response for. But the moment I wanted to say those words, you know, Dark Binding did connect, and obviously Cotnex came in for that gank. It's going to be a repeat gank.
Yeah, but no flash available this time. He managed to land the flash Sonic Wave. It's going to be a lot harder to land. He's backed off. He's going to go straight towards the white off the side there. JRE, meanwhile, he is going to back off, and farm-wise, still pretty even between the two. Look at that. Candy Panda just walks up, explosive shot straight to Jerry.
Yeah, but while farming, and Kreaton, I just don't really think he's focusing on it. I don't really think he's putting a lot of attention into that. And you know, when you've struggled two games in a row, it does affect your psychological play. And we just need to see, every time we look there, see how effectively Kreaton is trading with his opposite number. Anyways, Cotnex is holding Kreaton's hand. Darkbinding, can it connect? They're going in.
No flash, remember, for them this time around. He will try and get on towards Enrated. Have they got enough? They have! Cotnex finally gets himself first blood.
Punishing Enrated for that flash earlier on, where JRE was able to throw the Darkbinding out. Kill secured there for Cotnex. The repeated ganks working out, working in his favor. But it has cost Kreaton some CS. He should make that up shortly, though, as Candy Panda is going to get away. Can Svenskeren steal a blue buff? This is the question he's going in.
Hello, flash on towards him, pounce! And the unseen threat of a Kha'Zix catches on towards him. Candy Panda, oh, Dark Binding catches! Rocket jumps just at the right moment, though. Gets himself to safety.
Yeah, managed to queue up that rocket jump before the Dark Binding connected. So anyways, top lane is the lane we haven't looked at extensively. Kevin, with his sustain and his harassment, got a small CS lead, but it won't be much.
No, it's going to be a sustain versus a sustain, as Freddy will just clear out a bit of this wave. Well, it's a fairly passive lane, let's put it this way. I don't
think it's going to be exhilarating.
Too much.
It's going to be both ultimates damage reduction, both knockbacks, and, you know, CC. I'm sure it'll be exhilarating. But Kevin, with the with a Sheen first item, does signal it's going to be that Trinity Force. So
yep.
Very, very hoping to see this Emperor Palpatine. And you know, Kevin's got such a beef with Freddy because of how badly he's been beaten in those last two matches. You know, he really needs to get his horn stuck in and try to punish Freddy.
Any more?
I can, but I'm gonna save them a little bit.
You've been working on these overnight or what?
No. Just inspired by Joe casting the games yesterday.
That's
you know?
It. Yeah,
really got me excited.
Not at the moment. moment. Freddy, ooh, look at that. Popped his ultimate. Was a little worried that Kevin was ready to go for it. Of course, Keltnex was waiting just off the side there. Jez is warding out, giving him some coverage in this mid lane. Continue to farm. Oh, this one, it's a good dark binding landing, but look at Kraton. You can see his health. He cannot get involved in that one. Has to back off. And this bottom lane pairing of Jayri and Kraton has been under pressure throughout this series.
Yeah, they've really been struggling. And of course, you know, they are against a very frustrating lane to deal with because there is sustain there on Nami. So support versus support, but Enrated's got way more hit points. And Jerry's out of mana, actually. Ignite is available for Enrated. We'll see if he gets caught.
Oh, thought about going for it there. Managed to sidestep both the dark binding flash out of the light bind, and he will get away. It is a good point to mention, of course, for Millennium. They have incredible crowd control. So, evolution of the Void Spikes once again for Svenskeren, as we saw in the previous matchup when he played them. This is a deep, deep move, though, for Svenskeren. Caught out. Head before Rise. Laser comes through! Is it going to be enough? Tries to tank it through! Unbelievable! And Cornex, he's taken down at the side there with Jezzes.
Yeah, managing to survive. The summoner heal from Jezzes actually kept Svenskeren alive in that situation. And just turning it around, Millennium thought they'd caught them out. And even though that final spark did connect, it just wasn't enough damage. If that isn't an LCS big play, I don't know what is.
Absolutely fantastic stuff. The combo almost worked out. Jez is going to get himself the blue buff, though. Got himself his first kill of the game as he moves towards the Athenes. Kerb doing exactly the same. So, Cotnex has already tried to create pressure. It worked for him in the bottom lane, but he's now two deaths down. And again, it is starting. The trickle has begun for SK.
We'll see how quickly they can turn the trickle into a pull. Light binding.
Follow by.
That is so frustrating to Illid. Now this is one of the powers of Millennium Squad. You are gonna have like multiple CCs that can all work very well together. Put Void Ooze and that Lucian Singularity down from Lux on the ground, slow people down and line them up for that massive chain of roots. But what needs to follow up after is you need to get Kraton hammering away on that target, or Kerb has to have enough ability power to blow them up. And if he simply, if that doesn't happen, if they can't kill someone by the time that root runs out, that's all they really have. Then they're going to be reliant on Cotonex getting rid of the threats with his Dragon Rage, or obviously, alternatively, Kevin keeping them in place with that knockup. So we'll see if their primary initiation works out.
We shouldn't discount the damage that Kevin will have as that AD carry cow, effectively, you know, melee champion that can get involved. They do put out a lot of damages. AD ratios can get incredible. If he gets a Trinity Force and Static Shiv, and I think something like 300 plus AD, which is pretty high.
It is very scary, but he needs to get there first.
Yes.
Farming still behind Freddy, despite having a slightly, you know, strong start. It was initially Kevin that was bullying around Freddy, but this time around not working out. And Cotonex playing with his life a little bit. Svenskeren, if he jumped on it, maybe would have had a lot of damage.
Rubber ducky bouncing Kerb towards him, and instead he just turns it around, puts the light binding down, sidesteps, gets another basic attack with that passive down. Does not land the second skill shot. Svenskeren is waiting off at the side. Hasn't evolved his wings yet, so he can't pounce in quite as high as he'd like. Can't jump across that forested area just yet. Instead, he has to come around a traditional route, which doesn't look like it's going to work. But look at Jezzes. Look how much he's pressuring. Really trying to force this one. He wants to go back. Gonna buy up a second item. Probably going to be some boots, maybe. He's got the themes already completed. They will be the boots.
Yeah, the wave clear versus wave clear in that mid lane and just the ridiculous range is going to be very important when it comes to the siege and the counter siege. Now, SK, when they were dealing with the Ziggs in game one, played very passive and very slow. And I think Lux will have similar levels of wave clear. But Kraton has slowly got some control back in this lane. He was being bullied very early on. But since having access to Living Artillery and having that Phage in his inventory, it does look like Kraton and Jerry are playing more aggressively. The last two or three times we've poked our eyes down at this lane, we've seen Candy Pan and Rated on the retreat, out of risk of getting caught out. Tower dive top, they're going on the cow.
It's a tricky tower dive, that's for sure. He's got a lot of reduction here. He's trying to do what he can to try and kite it round. Freddy switches the aggro to Svenskeren, and Kevin lives for now. They trade back in, jump back in towards it. Svenskeren gets it.
Very well played. Second time he goes for the flash execute on Kha'Zix. We'll talk about that lane in just a minute. Millenium, they're looking for Candy Bat.
Mega Inferno bump does not land on anyone. Jayree manages to land the proc on towards Enraged. Life binding lands from long, long range there. And they do get the kill on the support. One for one trade. Top tower goes down. Still yet to get that dragon. Millenium, they have to win this trade and they have to get the dragon down.
They've got to be so careful of the bouncing bombs from Jez as he's running out of mana though, so time will be out. Fred is going to be teleporting, so this is going to turn into an engage. Candy Pan is still untouched as well. This is going to be a big one, D-Man.
It's a 5-on-3 though, that's for sure, so it's a big advantage, but it's SK that are forcing him away. Kevin goes in once again, pulverizer on towards Freddy, passes him in there. Connex strikes, but he gets caught out. Kevin now in trouble. Jez is trying to land the shots on towards him. Candy Panda has to back off there as Millenium engage, but they do not get the dragon. So job done by SK.
End up trading kills in that scenario, but yes, as you rightly pointed out, SK were the ones that got the objective in the tower in the top lane after diving Kevin. They managed to force him away and they got themselves the kill. But because Jez's was so low on mana and he'd used his Mega Inferno Bomb on the initial dragon engage, SK weren't able to do more. So Freddy teleports in just to give up his life while securing one kill in the process. Jez's, no more mana though. He's burned through his entire mana pool. It's going to be relatively useless for the next couple of moments, but it's not over. Dragon is still available. Cortex is coming in at full life, and I think this is the smart call from SK to back away.
Yeah, they need to back off from that one. Kurt was low, but still had the laser, so he could have fired from range. Also, we saw the entire Millenium team moving back in towards that one. Kevin's gone back to the top. They're not done yet, SK. They still want to make sure this is secured. It's the bottom lane they should be looking at. Kraton is going to back off, go towards that Trinity Force. Infinity Edge slowly being built out by Candy Panda. Meanwhile, Svenskeren, a bit of a regressive build this time around.
Yeah, he's got himself that Brutalizer once more. It is the armor pen Kha'Zix, which Diamond did in Super Week again.
Yep.
Svenskeren slightly deviated from the full damage route in game one, but we'll see what he decides this time. And Cotnex, obviously, Sidestone and Eastern, gonna be getting some wards down. He's been in the right place most of the time, and despite giving up a couple of kills, has felt more impactful, has felt like he's contributing to the team play. Millenium are only 1,500 gold down at about the 15-minute mark, which is one of the smallest disadvantages they've been in. And we'll see if they can even up their global gold. It is one tower, one dragon that can make it closer.
Well, they saw, of course, that Millenium had a number of people up towards the top there. SK quickly tried to move for this one. Jayree, quick black shield, stops that Aqua Prison landing. Dragon down to half hit points. They're going to have to take back away from this one. Svenskeren has taken way too much damage to get involved.
For a laser,
he could
maybe
easily get picked off if one of the dark or light bindings were to land. Instead, they get both get sidestepped. But Millenium, they are doing a good job at staying at range and making maximum usage of their abilities to poke them out. Svenskeren caught out. Is the laser not going to come through? Doesn't go for it. Doesn't pull the trigger.
No, he doesn't. Really want to focus on getting that blue buff. And SK continue to extend this engage with no blue buff on Jez's and obviously blue on Lux, it's going to be a very big advantage to Millenium. This has turned into a 15-minute dragon dance. We usually see this around Baron, and neither team's willing to give up that objective, but neither team really has the tools to instantly win. You know, the moment Kevin wants to jump into a team fight, he's going to get rooted by Freddy or knocked away by Tristana. The moment Freddy wants to jump into a team fight, he's going to get kicked away by Cottonex or rooted by Kerp and Jayree. So there's so many tools to deal with the limited initiation from either of these teams. That's why we're having these awkward extended standoffs.
Well, Jayree took a lot of damage there. Some good poke from SK, and they feel that may well be enough to go back in. They start the dragon off again. Millenium claps in. There's no movement from the bottom lane at the moment. Kratons continue to farm, and this dragon, I think he's going to be secured this time around. SK will take it.
Yeah, very easy. Millenium too slow to react.
Oh!
Start the fight, though.
Kraton there. Now is he going to get focused on? Can they try and get away from this one? Candy Panda moves in. Mega Inferno Bomb catches on towards Cornex. He's taken very low, but will survive. Meanwhile, back above, you can see Kevin and Kurt moving in. They cannot land any of that crowd control, though, and SK safely disengage.
Smarter positioning from SK and punishing Millenium for splitting up. Now Millenium, they can make a small turnaround. They've got minions moving up behind them, but Jez's should be in range to get some bouncing bombs down. We'll see how quickly or how long they commit to this tower push. But Millenium, they split up. They were in the middle lane, they were bottom lane, they wanted to farm, and SK rushed Dragon. I mean, it was a timing thing, and SK punished Millenium for being too far away and being too spread out.
So when Scrim comes around, he will see Kevin there. No, Trinity Falls still completed. He fancies it, goes in for it. Can he try and draw something from this one? Kerp instead throws out the Light Binding and the Lucid Singularity and will have to back away. So when Scrim got the ward.
Worth it, I think.
But the main thing to notice is just how much damage Finskirin is putting down. Whenever you see Alistar, your brain tells you tanky, but he's only got a Phage and a Sheen, so he's nowhere near tanky yet. And I made that mistake as a spectator yesterday, going, oh, Alistar's coming in, this is going to change. Why is he almost dead? There's no resistances or HP. So you have to remember that Kevin, while he doesn't have his ultimate up and running, he's not going to actually be a very, very big threat. He's got those boots of mobility, and we'll see if he can impact any of those side lanes.
So something
happen.
I want to point out here, actually, for Kerb, especially, because obviously Lux was a champion. We saw a lot of people running back in Season 3, and I distinctly remember Froggen talking about it. You know, the usage of the ultimate. His words were exactly, you need to use that ultimate the moment it's off cooldown every single time, non-stop. Continue using it. Don't save it, which is what Kerb seemingly has been doing. Obviously, we just saw him to use it to wipe that wave out, but you can see, used it, went back to base, comes back, it's back up. It's such a short cooldown. You have to keep firing it, keep just trying to land those shots.
I agree with you, and to expand on the point, if he had maybe called to go for the laser for the Dragonsteel, you know, it was pretty clear Millenium didn't want to go for the engage. Go for the blind steal. I mean, these guys have all got that sixth sense and game sense, and they knew Dragon was going on. They were making moves towards the pit, but it didn't happen. So we'll see how Kerb continues to use it. He's got that second level now of that final spark, so even lower cooldown, higher damage. But Millenium, they've just slowly been ground out of the game once more. Lost a Dragon, lost a tower, being out farmed in top, in jungle, in AD carry by a small margin. And it's just these small wins that is going in SK's favor.
One thing I always note with Candy Panda, and I love him for it because he's awesome, he hits the damn tower every time. He will walk up, get a couple of shots, and then back off. He is not afraid to put himself out there. Sometimes...
I'm so glad you say this.
Sometimes it puts him in a sticky situation, but he will always walk up, get a couple of auto attacks, and then back away. It's exactly what he needs to do.
Look at the damage.
Core tower. Yeah, Svenskeren got a lot of punishing damage. The Hex Drinker is now completed alongside that Brutalizer and the Elder Spirit. While this is all happening, of course, the top lane has been a bit of a problem. Kevin up against Freddy again is being forced back, out farmed and maybe outplayed.
And I want to reiterate, we talked about Kevin in the pregame. If Kevin is doing well and is able to perform in his lane, he's the front line that Millenium needs when they go for all of these engages. A lot of it rests off Kevin having strong and steady and stable performances. He's lost both of his games on Aatrox. He's behind in his game on Alistar. And I think Millenium have either misread Maokai or just underestimated him.
Ooh, flash use there. Freddy dodging out. Almost caught by the Light Binding. Remember, laser still being held. Candy Panda going aggressive on Kraton. The wave comes out from Enrated. Candy Panda in trouble, locked down. Soul Shackles goes off, forces the flash from Enrated. Finally, Millenium get themselves a kill in the bottom lane.
Yeah, well played by Kraton and Jayri. Took a long time for them to really go nice and aggressive. Trinity Force Cogmore is going to do more damage than an Infinity Edge Tristana. Just the whole kit of Coggins, especially if you just park yourself down and load with Living Artillery. So. Grabs himself a kill, grabs a tower as well, and that's going to close that gold lead. You can't bark up that tree. Freddy grabs the golem. He's just going to have some fun with it.
So, top lane, Freddy is dominating still. Absolutely dominating, Kevin. Yeah, I mean, he's, again, fallen behind in CS. Just unable to deal with the Maokai.
This game is going to be slightly drawn out if SK are to win it. And the reasoning... They want Freddy to become the unkillable, unchoppable wall tree, and they want Candy Panda to be relevant and have a power spike. I think the way SK played in game one was very telling. They wanted to hit their power spikes, they wanted to hit their itemization levels before they challenged. And then even when they were challenging, it was super risk averse, and it was very much about the safe plays. And it feels like that's what SK are doing again. You go back to all of those Dragon engages. SK danced around Dragon instead of committing. SK danced in and out, before stealing it away by having better positioning.
Well, Trinity Force is finally being picked up by Kevin. But SK, they are moving into the jungle. Blue buff is a possibility. Of course, Dragon is alive. Oh, JRE. He's going to walk straight in. He's not going to be able to survive the burst power of Svenska and a Candy Panda combined. That could well be the Dragon for SK.
Yep. Going to at least be one of those very powerful CCs that's not available. Teleports both up for the top laners, but no movement from Millenium. They're going to be giving that one up. There's no vision in the pit for Millenium either. SK have got decent wards in the blue buff area. Actually, very good wards in Millennium's blue buff area. We'll see if they can find Kerb. The satchel charge will slow him down.
Double.
Yeah, Bug's looking for him. We'll see if the Bug can splat Kerb.
Mines are not going to land, but the bouncing bomb will. The wave comes through. It's Mega Inferno bomb lands. The wave lands. In goes Kerb in trouble. And he will go down. Svenskeren gets on towards him. Leaps on towards Konex. Gets the reset kick used by Konex to force him away. We finally saw that laser coming out. That's the first time in around about 5 or 6 minutes since he last went back. He just keeps holding the trigger.
Yeah, I think Kerb was actually turning the light on to go to in his death. Simply didn't matter. He got ran down.
Dead, yeah.
Every single member of SK just chased him down. After punishing Millennium for being out of position, they grab a dragon.
Oh, Kratos
has jumped.
He's caught out. Freddy's going to catch on. Twisted advance. He will go deep, but he can tank out all that damage. Look at that. Candy Panda explosive shot just blows him away. Gets on towards it. Gets the double. On to JRE. Can he get the triple? May well fancy it. Flashes for it. Oh, Dark Finding caught out. Candy Panda run away, man. He will go down. Outplayed by JRE.
Yeah, you can't blame him for trying. Dark Binding as he lands. Now they're going to go for the cow.
Kevin, he's caught out. Light Binding, laser, Svenskeren. Just not enough damage coming out of Kerb right now. And Svenskeren, with the Hex Drinker, just shields it off.
Manages to walk away from that one. SK Gaming punishing Millennium over and over for being out of position and just really poor parding. That's very brave from Svenskeren. Still yet to back away. I guess he's far enough ahead, 115 CS to 61 on Cotton X. And just really great combination here from Millennium. Despite the fact that Kreatin pulled Freddy under a tower, Freddy took next to no damage. And let's just see, how close is that? One more hit, yeah, one more hit probably wouldn't have done it. We've seen the heal from Alistar, but knock up and Dark Binding, that's gonna cost him his life. And you can't blame him for trying. Why not? It would have got another tower if that kill had secured.
I think dreams of triple kill, quadra kill, and potential pentakill in the quarterfinals are flashing through Candy Panda's mind. Why not, like you mentioned, go for it there? It seems to be working out well for him now. Static shift is completed. You guys at home, well, that vote is swinging in SK's favor. 57% of you now getting behind them. And we've seen some big plays throughout this series as well. Millennium. Are they going down to a clean sweep, a 3-0? Will they be facing Super Hot Crew in that fifth place playoff? Kevin, meanwhile, that ultimate is not being used. He's holding on to it, doesn't have it available yet. Can he get it live? No! And Rated caught out. Laser comes through, but he lives. And still, the power is not there for Millennium as they slowly get beaten out of their own jungle.
Somebody on Reddit needs to make a punchline to the following opening line. A insect, a tree, walk into the top lane, and they order filet mignon Kevin. What's the punchline? Don't know.
I don't know.
But that was just an easy kill on Kevin. SK are romping across the map. There's nothing Millennium can do. And the moment somebody's alone, SK jump on them and kill them. Every single member of Millennium that's been alone for the last 5 minutes has died.
Yeah, and SK get themselves a blue buff for Jezzers. Oh. Nope.
Oh, scumbag Sven.
Svenskeren managed to get, I don't think he planned it. He just kind of hit him. The red buff, I think, finished it off.
Big smiles in Jez's face, at least.
Yeah, it's like,
he's not too frustrated. I'm sure he'll get his own one soon enough.
It's a 6,000, he's already got his own one. It's a 6,000 gold differential. Nevertheless, Svenskeren catches just about everything thrown his way. Bottom turret now going down. Candy Panda continues to move in with the wave and they're pinging it. SK are going to rotate around it. JRE low on health. The siege continuing and everything for SK is going their way. Look at Freddy waiting off the side. Kraton throwing out those saplings, getting the slows down on Millennium. They could push both towers at once.
I think they can. Candy Panda's been left unattested or uncontested for a while. And despite the long range engages, oh, the satchel! I think that made the laser miss.
Yeah.
Anyways,
yeah.
Kerb's been caught.
It caught out into
opted in. Laser, while it looked like he went off, didn't quite. Kevin now caught out, leaps in there. Svenskeren catches on towards in the Aqua Prison. Enough, and he will get a kill and just leaps on out. There is the inner turret going down. They can keep pushing this one, ladies and gentlemen. There's only three-man defense, and Jay Ree's got no help. The bouncy bomb's coming through. Inhibitor turret going down. It's another short game, surely, for SK Gaming as they continue to just charge through Millennium's base.
There is nothing Millennium can do. They were relying on their range. They were hoping that the Lux and the Morgana was going to be able to keep SK at arm's length and prevent them getting caught out. That simply isn't the case. That satchel went off just before that channel, that spell animation went down, and I think either cancelled it or made it miss. But regardless, it doesn't change a thing. Even if the damage had applied, Jezzes was still next to full health, and SK just continued running across it.
Fantastic stuff from SK Gaming. Millennium started so close, started so well. It was a tight dragon fight for a good 15 minutes, but SK Gaming just, once they sniff the lead, they just absolutely make it count, and they are doing wonderful things right now. Millennium, they're going to have to hope for some form of miracle. They're trying to find it in catching out Candy Panda in the jungle. He's off the side there as four members on Millennium push through down the bottom lane. Kevin singled out on his own. He's in trouble. He's going to go down. No doubt about that one. Svenskeren gets the kill on this one. While Millennium, what are they doing? They're waiting. They're trying to catch out. It's Enrated simply catching on support. You still don't even have the damage to finish him off. Connex comes around. They threw everything at just simply getting a kill on Enrated. Now SK close the net on towards him. Kraton fought out. He's going to go down. Jay Ree, the next focus. He will go down. It's a simple kill. Just a kill lane. I don't know what the call to call it. Simply SK just dominating Millennium. I don't even know what they were planning down the bottom there.
I agree. And I'm super happy that SK have proven me wrong. I was anticipating them to play safely and, you know, avoid those long-range skill shots, but because SK have been presented these opportunities of Millennium being out of position, they've not hesitated. SK have played aggressively, they've punished Millennium for being out of position, and they've continually just taken objective after objective. They've given up one tower this game, and the wave that Candy pushed a few minutes ago into this bottom inner turret will now be finished off, and it's just all about SK.
And you know, I recall the conversation I had, I think it was N-Rated or Candy Band, I'm not sure which one it was, just a couple of weeks back, and I said, who do you want? Who do you want to face in the quarterfinals? And it's like, Millennium, we know exactly what we're up against. We know what they're going to try and do, and we know how to play against it. And honestly, they've come into this quarterfinals with an absolute perfect strategy and just dominated Millennium, who just have not turned up.
Yeah, I completely agree. SK have responded to Millennium's picks and bans, and it is a combination, right? Because I think Millennium may have had their theories, may have had their strategies and their plans coming into this. Red side in games three, counter pick mid lane, but I don't think they've done it. You know, I don't think they actually executed the theory well at all. And in all three of the picks and ban phases, you can look at specific champions and go, why did you do that? What was the point of this? What were you hoping would happen? And then when you get in-game, they are also just mechanically not delivering to the standard we've come to expect. This is super weak Millennium, not the 10 weeks prior.
And this is super weak SK.
Yep.
Honestly, for me, you can look at every single lane. It's not just any particular lane. Freddy outplayed Kevin every single game. Svenskeren in the jungle has been brilliant. Called out once, but he made it count, quickly got straight back and got some kills. Jezzes, honestly, has done a lot better than Kerp in the mid lane. Kerp has been a fairly non-factor in all three of these games. The fact that he's got a Meki Soul Stealer on looks right now screams desperation. Candy Panda has been magnificent, simply. He's got, 20 plus kills already in just these three games. He's absolutely been dominant. And alongside him, Enrated has been brilliant, landing waves, landing dark bindings, landing everything that he needs to.
Yeah, SK have just completely stepped up their game. And with SK looking like they're going to close this one out 3-0, we very realistically could have a playoff bracket that looks like the spring split. I'll get to that thought in a second as Millennium. They're getting split off, but there's no Svenskeren.
Candy Panda's the focus target, but can they get him down? Everything thrown at him. The laser will finish the job. Now, can they make this something? Freddy's going to get tanked down. He will drop. Mega Inferno Bomb does a lot of damage coming out from Jezzes. They may well turn this one around. Everybody is still low. In comes Svenskeren. Finally, he joins the party a little bit late to this one, but was not invited. Connex instead comes in. It's a 3-0. 3-0 so far for Millenium. Can they make it count? They're going to have to push hard down the mid lane.
They need to make something special.
Oh, Svenskeren leaps in, gets himself one, gets the reset, jumps out, flashes. He can still keep picking him off. He's going to kite them around here. Graton knows, focused on N-rated. He gets caught out. It was a 4-for-1, but if they're going to go Baron, that is a big, big risk with Svenskeren still alive.
I feel like even with a massive team fight like that, Millennium were able to punish Sven for being on the top lane of the map. It was a positional error. Kevin is teleported back in. Sven now 1v4, and I don't know if he can steal this. Regardless, this is a tad risky. If Kotnex or Kerb go low, there is reset potential here.
Not going to risk
it. Nobody from SK is close enough. Okay, so Baron is big. The team fight itself was not necessarily the greatest of losses because SK still had a 10,000 gold lead. But getting Baron, having your teammates respawn, and having the buff available for the next fights, that's very important. All credit to Kotnex and JRE for catching Candy Panda and killing him, because the moment he was removed from the fight, it became infinitely easier. Sven and Candy are your consistent damage over time, auto-attack spells, and then Jez is hopefully spamming from long range. But obviously there was no spin that fight, so Millennium punish, and they win 5v4 convincingly, as well as getting Baron. Now they're back in it, but it is still a very, very, very big hill to climb.
And we just saw Kevin and Kreaton also taking the top turret down as well. So they've got themselves two turrets, and the Baron. Can they do anything else with it, or was it simply a fight of opportunity with everything working out? Candy Panda was singled out. And once those two carries kind of went down, it was Millennium that does prove they have a lot of power. So keep your eye on that Soul Steel, by the way. I want to see how that one stacks out.
How many stacks did he end up?
5 on it currently, so it's almost making it pay. I think 6 is the margin when it starts to actually work in your favor. So, not. It's a big risk, and it may well work out for him. But at the moment, SK, they're just going to take the time, you know, sit back. They're against the Baron up team right now, so it's not on them to do anything. It's down to Millennium to try and make use of this.
Yes, I agree. And for SK, now they might actually play more passively unless Millennium present solo targets. But for Millennium, with the Baron buff, they've bought themselves time. So the gold lead that SK had accrued will become less significant as the game extends for very obvious reasons. And in order for Millennium to claw this lead back, they want to make use of Baron to either scare SK away and get towers or dragons. Dragon's going to be up in 30 seconds. Millennium appear to be grouping for probably that very objective. But we'll see if they can make a play on the middle turret first. And the moment Millennium start clawing back that objective gold, now the burst damage from Kerb becomes scary. Now the Darkbinding from JRE is more threatening as well. But they've got no minions to work with, so can't go for the towel.
Well, that's the problem. They're pushing up against Ziggs. He can wave clear, no problem. Candy Panda alongside him on Tristana, explosive shot. That wave will not last.
Svenskeren with his Void Missile spikes, you know, Void Missiles rather, got the Black Cleaver, got a Hex Drinker in there. I mean, he is also no slouch at clearing minion waves. And actually,
sneaky.
That's just going to sneak it. Millennium, I don't even know if they're aware that dragon was up, because they made no move towards it, and they need to. They need to be making use of Baron. It's a deterrent for combat, and they haven't done that.
Well, every time they step forward, they get those Void Spikes in the side, slows them down, and they step away. This turret, simple outer turret, they can't get it down. Millennium trying anything, they're trying to land the picks. You can see the Sonic Waves are away going in, the Dark Bindings are going in, the Light Bindings are going in. They want to manage to land something on Jezzes or Candy Panda, but they're playing defensive.
So if Millennium keep it up, they do have minion waves in top and bottom pushing in their favor. But it feels like it's a little too late, if I can be that harsh, because those minion waves are going to take quite a while before they get to a tower. And the moment Millennium peel away from the mid lane, they've got to deal with a Mega Inferno Bomb for wave clear, so that instantly eliminates one threat. And they're not going to make it to the opposite side of the map, to the other minion wave. So it just feels a little half-hearted. Let's see what Jezzes does. There you go. So top wave completely destroyed. But Millennium, they're going to tank this without minions.
Oh, and rated. The laser was finally used from Kerb. Look at it. It's such a short cooldown. Make more use of that spell. They are not throwing it out half as much as I'd like to see. Instead, it's another chunk of wave clear. Jezzes is back.
and they can't push anything in. Freddy's happy to save those dart bindings. He can tank through that one. Every spell that gets used, he's going to regenerate a little bit more health.
And he's going to have the sustain from Inrater to help back him up. Baron buff has worn off, and Millenium...
didn't even make a dent in the tower.
Able to stall. Able to stall. To be fair, they did get a few auto attacks, but no. I mean, they spent 2.5, 3 minutes literally watching SK wave clear. That is exactly... And then when Jezzers disappeared, they're like, okay, we'll sneak a few hits. Jezzers will let us have these. And then they ran away. It is still a 11,000 gold lead. It is still a matter of Millenium having little tools to contain SK. And still, they made a lot of individual positioning mistakes, which is why Millennium's in this position. Kevin's gone the tanky route, so let's see if he can sustain or keep a teamfight going long enough for Creighton's Cogmore to be relevant.
I don't think he had time to get the static shift, honestly. I don't think he was able to do any of that split pushing that maybe he wanted to do, maybe originally planned to do for Saw, maybe. But SK Gaming pushing on through the mid lane. Now it's their turn. They have that gold lead. They're well aware of it. It worked well for them in the past. Now they're, I think, maybe going to flex some of that muscle and prove why they managed to just charge through that mid lane and expose that inhibitor. It was Hound, of course, now and has respawned. So Millenium are on defensive duties without a tower.
Yeah, the aggressive positioning from SK, knowing that Baron's down, is just such a confident tell that they're going to look to punish. And despite Freddy eating multiple dark bindings, no one else from SK has been caught. No one else has been punished. Let's see if Candy Panda going aggressive for the inhib can get him caught out, because it is something that does happen from time to time. And there's also the threat of a flash soul shackle engage. The Millenium, time is running out. They need to go in now if they want to try and make a fight happen.
Well, the inhibitor, I think they're accepting the fate that will go down. Cotnex was trying to make a play. It's Svenskoni's caught out with the Sonic Wave, and I think he's going to follow that one. And Freddy runs defensive duties while the rest of his team rotate up, and that's going to be an inner turret because Millenium are too slow to react to this one. Candy Panda has a gigantic wave with him, and Millenium are, again, too late to this party.
Yeah, Millenium too scared to engage the inhibitor, so they don't defend that. Then they're too slow to respond to the top lane minion wave, and SK get uncontested objectives. And just very smart play. I mean, I think SK is very well deserving of all of the accolades that they have in this series. It was a slow start in game one, and I was nervous, I'm not gonna lie. I was worried about the level from both teams because Millenium was struggling and SK appeared to be struggling. But they've definitely shaken off the rust in games two and three and come out swinging.
Well, Baron now up, SK in position and waiting for someone from Millenium to take a peek. Instead, Jezzers is simply putting damage down from the side. Millenium looking to continue pushing. Are they going to go for the turret first? It's something they've been working
they
for.
They can get surrounded. Oh, tidal wave could cause trouble.
Freddy popped the ultimate. He wanted to go for that one, but it wasn't quite close enough. That Twisted Advance, of course, hasn't got the range he once had, which is why he wasn't able to get close. Had flash available if he really wanted to go for it. And this is exactly the same position we saw them in the last time. Millenium came out on top. Oh, Kerb caught out. With a quick heal comes on towards him. Kevin now in trouble. How can he tank through all of the damage at the moment? He's going to come around the side. Creighton off the side, untouched so far. Jezzers gets in. They're all close, lined up. The laser lands. Candy Panda has the rocket jump out of there. Kevin will finally go down, and Rated takes all the damage. It's a one-for-one trade so far. Both top laners picked off. Svenskeren looking to try and finish this one. Candy Panda flashes in for it. Gets one, gets two. Svenskeren gets the reset. Candy Panda straight in there. He will. Goes in towards Karnak. Gets on towards him. He will go for the reset. Is it going to be enough? He's just going to void spikes back up the moment. It will finish him off. No! Gets away, but the base is exposed and SK can push it.
There are super minions pushing up the middle lane. Jez is going to look to interrupt Kerb. If he can kill Kerb, then is there wave clear? Mega Inferno Bomb's
super
not available.
Base.
Look at the base. As long as Jez keeps Kerb away, there's nothing to clear the minions away. It's SK done. Have done it.
It's over. SK Gaming, they're going to take this one 3-0. There's nothing the Millennium can do. And it's a fantastic performance. SK will go through and face Alliance in the semi-finals of the European Regional Championships. Can they make it to World Championships? They are one step closer. And that is a beautiful sight. Fantastic 3-0 for SK. Dominant, dominant performance here in the quarterfinals.
Yeah, Freddy's going to be so happy with that performance. He's leafing here today with a massive smile on his face. and he's firmly rooted himself in the top, you know, a top team here in Europe. This is the second split in a row where the same four teams are in the top four.
Yep. And, well, last time around, history proved the Rocket actually took down Alliance for that third spot. Can SK and Fnatic make it to the finals, just like they did in the spring?
I don't know, because game one is still, there's so many questions for me regarding SK in game one, and I think it was a safe play. I really think they were maybe anxious about the engage and they were worried about Ziggs. But if that is not the answer, it was very slow. And you contrast that to game two and game three. So decisive, so coordinating. Would Alliance make the same positional errors to allow SK to build that lead up? And I don't think they would.
And we talked about it yesterday with the challenger game, the Unicorns of Love versus Ninjas in Pajamas. You know, we said, is this simply ULO playing so well or NOP playing so bad? And you've got to ask the same questions today. Have SK been that solid? It looked like they were, but Millenium, they really look shaky.
They did. And I've got one more in me that I'm going to get out of. I think Kevin's going to be in a very bad mood after that game. The Alistar didn't work out, and neither did his Aatrox. It's just a tough day at the office for Kevin and the rest of the team.
For everyone involved in Millennium, yep. Honestly. Kevin yep. played outstanding, and maybe the pick strategy, did it work? You know, they let that first pick choice go through, and three out of three times, Freddy absolutely pulled out a beast. Maokai twice, and Nidalee in the top, first pick every time. Actually, Morgana was first pick last time in the second game too.
It was, and I also think if you step back and look at the three games, two of the games are not necessarily pick comps. Maybe, yes, you could argue Lux, Morgana, Land Bindings, you can pick them off, but it's not a Millennium-style pick comp. Millennium-style is a lot more aggressive, in-your-face aggro. Braum, Fizz, you know, Twisted Fate if it was available, those kinds of things to jump in. And Millennium may have been scrimming and practicing other compositions out of fear of being countered by their picks, but I think they may have thought about it, may have gone back to that game three. Instead of running Lux and Alistar and Morgana, maybe gone for Aatrox, maybe gone for Fizz, gone for Braum, and tried to do something that they won so many games within the regular summer split.
And on to SK Gaming, of course. They're going to be facing Alliance now. Lost to them 3-1 overall over the split. Can they turn it around? Can they manage to take down Alliance, who honestly have been a juggernaut this season?
Yeah, I agree with you, and I think I'm going to use an analogy that we said yesterday. SK have probably got a very similar skill ceiling to Alliance, but they have demonstrated that their skill floor is lower or less consistent. Mm. You know, Alliance have been at a much higher basic level. Even an Alliance average game has not been particularly worrying, whereas some of SK's games you've looked at and you've gone, ooh, I'm not really sure what they were thinking or what they were doing there. So if they can adjust and deliver at a higher level, we're going to have one hell of a series at Gamescom.
Yeah, it's going to be fantastic. Semi-finals, of course, that's coming up next Friday. For now, though, we're going to speak to the winners. Shox is standing by with two players.
Thank you very much, D-Man. I'm here with SK's bottom lane, Candy Panda and Enrated. First off, congratulations, guys. A clean 3-0 sweep here. Enrated, let me ask you to begin with, is this 3-0 sweep, is that a relief or is that a confirmation of what you already knew or is it a combination?
I think it's a combination. Every one of us feels relieved because there was so much pressure on our shoulders for the last weeks. We've constantly tried to improve and did everything we could towards that. We had a lot of training, a lot of preparation going into this match, and we had the right mindset and we came in here to win. So a 3-0 wasn't unexpected, but we wouldn't say that it was easy to win those matches at all, because being on such a big stage, playing a best of five means everything is on the line, and we just made the better play and that made us win in the end.
Yeah, absolutely. Candy Panda, talk me through maybe first the first two games where it seemed like you guys had the upper hand in picks and bans already and your preparation was already showing off.
Yeah, so we focused a lot on comfort picks for us, and we knew that we would be blue side a lot since we had the better seed. So we were three games blue side at least, and then they choose the blue side. So we knew we had to blind pick mid, and we prepared like some champions, which we can just blind pick. And I think also the bottom lane wasn't aware of that they can't really play Alistar against Morgana, because it really screwed them over. Two games, they got just outpicked in the bottom lane, and yeah, they just picked a bit weaker champions than we did, I think.
Yeah, well, talk me then through the third game, because then finally they came out with a Kog'Maw Morgana combo themselves, and you guys went then for Nami Tristana. Then talk me through that. Was that an adjustment in mindset, or did you know, well, just give us any lane, we can probably do it?
No, we knew they would probably either ban Kog'Maw or Morgana, or even both, or they would chicken pick it right away. And I said, like, to Enraid that we can just play Tristana and Nami, and it will be fine, and it was fine.
And Enraid, then talk me through the third game, because it was actually the only game maybe that you guys had some resistance from Millenium, then they got the Baron and the Lux coming in there. What was the tricky thing about that game three?
The matchup overall was really good for us on bot lane. Like, Tristana, Nami is supposed to beat Kog'Maw and Morgana. The problem was that they drew my flash early because of so much lead presence, so the lane was kind of even though it should be in our favor. But we didn't get that much help, so in the end we could get advantage all around the map just because of that, and that paid out for us.
Yeah, well, it paid off. 3-0, clean sweep, you're on to the semifinals, and you were mentioning actually beforehand to me as well, this is such a totally different feeling. Everything is on the line. You mentioned here again, next week you're in Gamescom in front of thousands of people. Talk me through how you will prepare for that and maybe keep the nerves in check.
We have practiced a lot for this week, like as much as we possibly could. So we will keep up the practice and specialize our preparation towards Alliance and give our best shot at going to Worlds.
Yeah, is there anything you guys want to say to the fans out there, maybe Candy Panda, supporting you guys still?
Oh yeah, I would like to say thanks to the fans that like keep sticking us out, even though in like week 6 to 9 we went really bad because we didn't play. But like we knew we could come back, and I hope our fans knew it as well. So it's great if they still support us.
Well, you guys are back. You guys are absolutely on fire. Congratulations, and see you guys in the semifinal.
Thanks.
Thank you.
All right, now let's head back over to Demon and Quickshot once again for an update on the playoffs.
Thank you, Jox. And after dropping that series today, Millenium will now face Super Hot Crew in the fifth place match. That will be happening next Thursday at Gamescom, of course, where the losing team will head to the Spring Promotion Tournament and face the Challenger squad of their choosing.
Yeah, of course, by winning the series, SK Gaming will take on Alliance in the semifinals next Friday, right after Rocket goes up against Fnatic. And three of those four teams will be heading to the 2014 Worlds. We'll know who that is after that third place match next Saturday, followed by the finals on Sunday.
Yeah, it's going to be absolutely awesome there, ladies and gentlemen. Do not miss it. Of course, those matches are all happening at Gamescom next week. Don't know where my voice went there. Right after the International Wildcard Tournament, that's going to be beginning on Wednesday, August the 13th at 11 a.m. Central European Summertime. It's early. That's 2 a.m. Pacific. So good luck watching that if you're in America. And a round robin between Oceania's Legacy Esports, the Commonwealth Independent States, Russian Force, and Turkey's Dark Passage. Hell of a lot of matches right there.
It will be. Hoping for tiebreakers, of course. The top two teams from that round robin will play in a best of five on Thursday, and the winning team will head to Worlds to represent their respective region.
Yeah, of course, over in North America, they've got the South American teams. It is going to be fantastic, ladies and gentlemen. That wraps up the quarterfinal series, but when we return in a moment, the European Challenger Summer Finals will be kicking off as H2 Gaming will take on SK Gaming Prime. We'll be back in just a moment. Freddy's going to catch on. Twisted Advance, he will go deep, but he can tank out all that damage. Look at that. Candy Panda, explosive shot, just blows him away. Gets on towards it, gets the double. Now SK, close the net on towards him. Kratos born out. He's going to go down. JRE, the next focus, he will go down. Kevin will finally go down, and Rated takes all the damage. It's a one-for-one trade so far. Both top laners picked off. So let's go and looking to try and finish this one. Candy Panda flashes in for it, gets one, gets two.